So the typical varus which we commonly see is a primary varus in which the varus deformity is produced by the loss of meniscus, lot of medial cartilage and bony erosion in the medial compartment. This is called a primary varus. And some patients, especially those who present earlier, there may be a metaphyseal deformity leading to a varus, which is called metaphyseal varus. Ideally, these people are the ones who respond the best to an ITBL osteotomy. The HTO can be almost curative for these patients with the metaphyseal varus with medial joint osteoarthritis. Sometimes the varus can be aggravated by a very lax lateral structures, in which the varus is not only due to bony deformity and bony erosion, but also due to lax lateral ligaments. This is called a double varus deformity. And finally, neglected or malunited medial tibial condyle depressed fractures can also lead to varus deformity, which is called intra-articular varus. So it's very important to identify what pattern of varus you are dealing with when you're treating these patients for HTO. So metaphyseal varus can be identified by this angle called tibial bone varus angle, which is the angle between the mechanical axis of the tibia and the proximal tibial metaphyseal axis. If it's more than 5 degrees, it indicates a metaphyseal varus. These are the patients who respond very well to a high tibial osteotomy. Go for the radiological planning. Apart from routine weight-bearing x-rays, lateral views, and skyline views, Rosenberg views can show an early MGOA, and Strex x-rays may be needed to identify ligament laxity. And very importantly, one has to get a full-length standing x-rays. In the coming slides, I will tell you how to take this full-length standing x-rays. This is how we do in our institution. The patient usually stands at around 10 feet from the source of x-ray. And we use a long multi-cassette device here in which the image is taken up by 4 cassettes and the software stitches the images for us. And it's very important to have a radiological marker in the x-ray. Ideally, we use a round metallic ball of 3 centimeter diameter, which is strapped around the lower part of the thigh in the plane of the bone in the sagittal section. And usually we use around 80 to 100 kV exposure. And nowadays, even Indian manufacturers are coming out with this kind of a multi-cassette setting with softwares to get a proper full-length standing x-rays. You don't have to invest in a very high-end equipment like I shown before. This is what we have in our outpatient clinic. This is also quite okay. But most importantly, you have to have a radiological marker so that you can exactly calculate how much of opening which you have to do it later. So this is an example of a standing full-length x-ray. Once you get an x-ray, you have to see whether it has been taken properly or not. First, look for the anterior superior iliac spines, whether they are at the same level. And in the knee, the patella should be centered and facing forward. And the femoral condyle should be clean very clearly without overlapping on the tibia. So this is an example of a properly done standing full-length x-ray. So this is very important to get this x-ray because entire surgical planning and your execution of the osteotomy depends on this particular x-ray. And once you have the x-ray, I'll be showing how to plan the x-rays on a simple lobby using these diagrams and also some slides showing how the x-rays you can draw these lines and calculate your wedge for opening wedge osteotomy. So once you have this full length x-ray, you have to construct the weight bearing line, which is the line that connects the center of the femoral head to the center of the ankle joint. In a normal knee, this weight bearing line falls near the center of the joint, slightly more medial. And in a varus knee, it will fall much more medially. If it's more than 15 millimeter medially, it is termed as a significant mechanical axis deviation. The aim of osteotomy is to bring this mechanical axis to the lateral compartment. Normally, we don't take it all the way to the Fujisawa point, which is 62.5% of the mediolateral joint line. Nowadays, we shift the line to somewhere around the lateral tibial spine, which may result in 3 to 4 degrees of valgus. But if you're facing with a significant wear and tear of the cartilage, if it's 2/3 or near complete loss, you may want to shift the weight bearing line much more further laterally so that you'll have a better unloading effect and better longevity of the high tibial osteotomy. So once you do the weight bearing line, then you have to calculate certain angles. First one, which I would like to draw your attention, is called the medial proximal tibial angle, which is shortened as MPTA. This is an angle which is formed by the mechanical axis of the tibia with the tibial articular surface joint line. The angle is formed on the medial side. Normally, it is around 87 degree plus or minus 3 degree. If the varus is coming from the tibia, obviously this angle will be reduced. When you are doing an opening wedge high tibial osteotomy, you will be increasing the angle. But there is a limit to which you can increase. Normally, it is around 94 degree. Beyond that, you may end up in having an oblique joint. And we'll see that in later slides. So MPTA normally is around 87 degree. You can correct it up to 94 by doing a high tibial osteotomy. The next angle, what you should know, especially when you're dealing with valgus knee, is a lateral distal femoral angle. The mechanical lateral distal femoral angle is the one which is between the mechanical axis of femur and the distal femoral joint line. Obviously, it will be decreased in a valgus knee. And then one should look for this tibial slope in the x-rays. And one should be aware that if you are doing an opening wedge osteotomy, there is a tendency to increase the slope. And when you're doing a closing wedge osteotomy, there is always a tendency to decrease the slope. Now, the purpose of our planning is not only to assess the amount of varus and shifting the weight bearing line. Your planning method should tell you in millimeters to how much you are going to open the opening wedge osteotomy. So this is the intended outcome of your planning method. In this presentation, we'll be seeing a method called the Miniacci technique. And the first step, you draw a weight bearing line like this here. And the next step would be to draw the intended new weight bearing line. Here you can see it is going near the 60% mark here. So this is going to be your new weight bearing line. It's very important that this new weight bearing line should be of the same length of the weight bearing line that is AB and AC. In an X-ray, normally what you do is you draw a line from the ankle joint lines. Then you project this line so that the new weight bearing line touches this ankle joint line like this here. So depending on the amount of wear and tear, you will be shifting the weight bearing line farther down your lateral compartment. And this is how it's been done in an X-ray. You can see this is an ankle joint. We have extended the ankle joint horizontally. And then the new weight bearing line, the intended weight bearing line, connects the center of the femoral head to the through the point of correction, then up to the extension of the lateral ankle joint line here. So this is a point C. The next step would be to mark your hinge point. Normally the hinge point is marked just below the tip of the femoral fibular tip, corresponding to the epiphyseal marking of the fibula, a centimeter away from the lateral tibial cortex. So this would be your hinge point. And next step would be to draw another line from the point C to this hinge point. And based on this hinge, we are going to move the point B to this point C. So we need to know the angle between the C hinge point and the B. So this is what we need to do. So we need to have this angle CDB like this. So the same thing being shown on this films here, you mark the hinge point and you construct the triangle here. And next thing would be to, based on the hinge point, the same angle is subtended onto the medial tibial cortex, and then you construct a triangle. The base of the triangle is measured, and according to the magnification ratio, you will get the intended level of amount of opening of the wedge in millimeters. Okay, so here you can see in this X-ray, this is a shadow of the spherical ball we kept. We know the size of the ball is 30 millimeter in diameter. And when you are measuring in the X-ray, you are getting a length diameter of around a centimeter, 10 millimeter. The magnification index in this case would be 30 by 10, that is 3. And then here you can see this angle is around 16 degree. And here there is an important index called joint line congruence angle, which indicates the excessive joint opening due to soft tissue laxity. The normal value of this joint line congruence angle is around 2 degree, and anything above 2 degree should be subtracted from this correction angle here. So we have drawn a triangle with an angle of around 15 degree with this hinge point as apex. And this base is being now measured as 5 millimeter. Now this magnification index is 3. So in real scenario, you need to have 5 × 3, 15 millimeter of correction. So this is an example to show how you can use this technique to calculate your wedge. It's very important to note that pre-op planning is much more important than perioperative checking, because when you're using techniques like cable wire or long rods to check the intraoperative correction, there will be a lot of chances of parallax error and you'll end up having inadequate or excessive correction in your cases. So it's very, very important to have a proper preoperative planning and also the amount of which you're going to open based on proper x-rays. And these are the special scenarios here. So you have to be very careful when you're seeing a gross deformity like this on the right side here. And based on the software calculation, you can see if you want to correct the weight bearing line, even just lateral to the lateral tibial spine, you're getting a medial proximal tibial angle of 101.3 degree. So I mentioned the MPTA upper limit is 94. So this is much more MPTA here. That means once you do an osteotomy, the joint is going to be like this. The joint surface is going to be very much oblique with relation to the long axis of the tibia. So this joint line obliquity can result in a lot of shear forces, can lead to wear and tear and poor long-term outcomes following high tibial osteotomy. So one should avoid this excessive joint obliquity. That's where keeping the MPTA below 94 is very, very important. So when you're facing with the large corrections, sometimes you may have to distribute the corrections to the femur and tibia. So one may want to do a double level osteotomy in this kind of cases. This is an example of 42-year-old male. If you had done only HTO, you would have had an MPTA of around 97. Hence, a double level osteotomy was done, which resulted in an MPTA of around 91 degree. So this is an example. When you are having a large corrections, look at the resultant MPTA and see if you can get away with a double level osteotomy. And second problem one can face is an intra-articular varus. You're trying to do an high tibial osteotomy. You are not going to change the incongruence of the tibial articular surfaces. The pagoda deformity will still be there and you'll have what is known as a teeter effect. So you have to be very careful. I think we have a talk on intra-articular osteotomy. One should not get carried away and do a high tibial osteotomy for a very significant depressed medial condyle, tibial condyle fractures. And one should be aware of tibial slope. One should not ideally change the tibial slope, but when you are doing ligament surgeries, sometimes you can play with your tibial slope. So when you are facing doing an osteotomy for a PCL deficient knee, you can increase the slope, which can compensate for a PCL deficient knee. When you are doing an ACL deficient knee, you should try to decrease the slope, which can help to support the ACL deficient knee. One can also do recurvatum corrections using slope corrections. That is a different procedure altogether. And HTO is a very rewarding procedure. It can be used along with other joint preserving options like this by root repairs along with HTO. Usually patients who have good results with one knee, they come and ask for it in the next 1 or 2 years. So it's very not uncommon to see people with bilateral high tibial osteotomies in our practice. And root repair, this is an example of a root repair on the left side with varus still surviving. On the right side, we have combined root repair with HTOs. And the cartilage repair along with HTO is another scenario where we found HTO to be helpful. To conclude, HTO is a very rewarding procedure. It's very important to get a proper long leg standing views. And you can plan your osteotomy using traditional method like as shown, or you can also use a few softwares which are available. Success depends on patient selection and radiological planning. And once again, I thank for the opportunity given to me, and thanks everyone for your attention. Over to you, Rajiv.
Thank you, Dr. Kleiman, for a nice lecture, how to plan ahead and how to go ahead. Then, Rajiv, do you take the questions first or we'll just finish the lectures one by one?
I think we will we'll take question also. We can take question right now. Yeah. Sudeep?
Sudeep, if you can take any question or any question, query from any of the faculty, you can take that.
Okay, sir. Right. Till now, we haven't got any question, online questions we haven't got. So if there are any important points that both of you wants to highlight for the younger people taking up the surgery, just to discuss among yourself, can go ahead and ask any question. So any age group, so I have heard John sir in the past and all of you in the past, and I think the age probably is not a bigger criteria nowadays. But what about lateral joint line arthritis, lateral compartment arthritis? How diligent you are when you're looking just on X-ray, you make that decision, or do you do anything else? Do you put an arthroscope? So can you just elaborate on this?
I do scopy for all the patients, because primarily I'm a scopy surgeon. Then we started doing STOs for ligament, neglected ligament tears. So it is my practice. I do a lateral. But if you want to assess clinically, one is clinical examination. And one can also do a stress X-rays. So lateral valgus stress X-rays. If you are able to find a good joint space despite the valgus stress, that means there is a good amount of cartilage present on the lateral side. So this is one way you can assess your lateral compartment clinically.
Any, John,
yeah,
sir?
So I think we had this discussion in a osteotomy group meeting with Professor Lobenhofer there. And they have gone away to do routine, from doing routine arthroscopies for this problem. Mm-hmm. Usually what they do is they try to do an MRI first. Okay, they look at the lateral. Now with the cartograms, you can actually get a good idea of the lateral cartilage as well as any intra-articular pathology. So if there is a significant intra-articular pathology that they need to, then they would deal with that at the same time. Otherwise, they would just go ahead and do an osteotomy and not actually do it. But I think the other way is to look in. But you have to, the only problem with the arthroscopy is because you may possibly increase the risk of infection, not significantly, but probably by a small degree.
I think two options are there. Either you can go for a cartilage mapping or a diagnostic arthroscopy. So
yeah,
I think some people go for a diagnostic arthroscopy, or you can go, if your center allows a cartilage mapping, you can have it. You can see the cartilage loss there. You can avoid arthroscopy. But we also practice do routinely arthroscopy before planning for STOs to see the cartilage status. Sometimes you have degenerative meniscus tear also. You can deal with those condition also.
So I've got a doubt on that, because sometimes we see, because in our country we see more of many young age ladies coming with this varus, and they are having their varus thrust guest. So what investigation and what is your message to the juniors, how to investigate and how to go ahead with this typical varus with the varus thrust guest?
So I think varus thrust is a problem that you will get with any significant varus in the knee, and there's some stretching out of the lateral ligament. But usually, you don't need to do a separate procedure for that. When you correct your alignment, it tends to settle down. But if you actually have a ligamentous laxity, that's a definite ligamentous laxity, or a problem with the lateral collateral, then you have to deal with it. But most lateral...
Clement sir, you want to add something?
No. As what sir has told is right, but you have to be careful that it indicates there is a soft tissue component to the varus, and if you are careless, you may end up overcorrecting, because that component of varus which is occurring due to soft tissue should not be correcting in your bone. So that's the tricky part in varus stress. But there is definitely, if you see a varus stress, they do very well after osteotomy.
So Rajiv, the varus thrust is of double varus thrust and triple varus thrust. So if patient is having a medial compartment VOA with double varus thrust, that is only lateral collateral ligamentous laxity is there. That patient tolerated very well with your STO. If there is triple varus thrust, means along with the varus deformity, there is external rotation of the tibia also. The tibia compensated that varus with the external. It means there is problem with the posterior lateral corner also. So such type of patient usually needs some type of soft tissue surgery at the same time if there is clinically triple varus thrust is there. My question to Joseph, sir, how much amount of patellofemoral arthritis do you accept with this medial compartment osteoarthritis? Because many a times there is component of patellofemoral osteoarthritis also associated with medial compartment osteoarthritis.
It's a clinical assessment rather than going with radiology. I have seen in my patients who had mild patellofemoral symptoms, developing worsening of patellofemoral symptoms, but the tibiofemoral symptoms are resolved. But they can't climb the stairs. A lot of people have suffered for 6 to 8 months. So basically, I evaluate the patellofemoral joint before osteotomy and try to look at what kind of problems do they have. If they have excessive lateral pressure syndrome or a global patellar pressure syndrome or diffuse patellofemoral OA or patellofemoral baking. So usually nowadays I tend to, if it's minor symptom, predominant is medial joint, okay, I take up and I try to address the patellofemoral symptom as well. Some of the procedures which I've been doing concurrently along with osteotomy or lateral retinacular lengthening and partial lateral fistectomy, those things have been helpful in my practice. People who have a diffuse patellofemoral pain, especially the medial facet of the patella is painful, they do very poorly after osteotomy. This has been my experience. So nowadays, I tend to identify the problems and quantify the problems, if possible, address along with STO.
And I think that's similar for the lateral compartment. If you have significant lateral compartment problems, then you shouldn't be doing this because then you're going to overload the lateral compartment and make that situation worse.
One question, sir. While doing STO, there is always a possibility that the tibial slope might change. So what intra-articular precautions should we keep so that the tibial slope doesn't change? Sir Clement, sir.
You're not audible, Clement.
So there is a possibility of change in the tibial slope while doing HTO. So what precautions should be kept in the mind so that the slope doesn't change? Am I audible?
I think this will get covered in second
time. I think in technique, I think. In HTO technique, we will cover this question, Manish.
Yeah.
We can go with our next talk, I think. Sure. Dr. Bhushan will be talking.
Yes, we'll go ahead with the next talk.
Technique of HTO, and we will take this question.
I'm sharing my screen just now.
Yeah, please, Dr. Bhushan. Clement, sir, some audio issues there.
Yeah, I think it's fixed.
Yeah, now it's correct. Yeah, yes.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can see your slide, Bhushan. Yeah.
So, we can talk Clement as usual. So, Clement has majorly covered all the theory of the high tibial osteotomy. Let's look at some practical steps. So I've done it slightly different today. I'm going to show you the surgical video as it was recorded. There's minimum change in the video aspect, but we'll go through the steps as we're doing it. So this is a video of standard high tibial osteotomy, and I'll keep on talking as the video is going on. So you're obviously welcome to stop anytime you want, and we'll discuss a few key steps at the end of the video. So I normally like to do all the HTOs in a normal TTR position. I'm a fairly simple person. I like to keep one position of the knee for everything I do. So TTR, AGB, or HTO. Everything is in the same position with a foot bolster and a side support like a TTR. The knee is in about 70 to 80 degrees of flexion as such. I do the surgery through a small medial longitudinal incision, and I try and buzz this neurovascular bundle, the saphenous nerve and neurovascular structure. It does give a lot of numbness on the lateral side, but I usually warn the patient that this is going to happen. I stop trying to find the nerve and trying to save it. It doesn't help. It doesn't work in my hand. So this patient is slightly red-patted, as you can see. So there's a good big layer of fat that needs to be detected all the way down till you get the white face facial layer. So normal blunt and sharp dissection is combined to locate the face fascia. If you can look at the marking done, there's a marking for the tibial tubercle, the medial joint line, the anterior and the posterior margin of the tibia. So once you have reach the layer of the face, things become quite easy. And then you can decide on the level of your osteotomy and how to release the soft tissue. Now, various incisions have been described. We'll discuss about this. So various people have various techniques of doing it. I think whatever works best in your hand should be done. Now, as you can see, I exposed the face fascia there. And I like to release the face fascia along with the medial collateral ligament in an L-shaped manner in a subperiosteal fashion. So I've given the suction to my study because it's a lot of barbecue kind of smell. And I'm making the vertical limb of the L that is going just medial to the medial border of the patellar tendon. And there is a horizontal limb which is at a sharp 90 degrees angle. The reason for doing this is that we can get a good hold on the face fascia. And as we start releasing the face fascia from the bone along with the periosteum, the dissection is quite easy. It really peels off very easily all the way to the posterior part of the tibia. As you can see, I'm using the cochlea as a saw and just cleaning the structures as it goes. It generally doesn't bleed. There's normally a consistent bleeder at this level, which needs to be cauterized. And we need to go all the way to the back of the tibia. And it's important not to chicken out here and do a complete release all the way to the back. Now, once you come there, you start seeing the shiny MCL there. So that structure you see here, that's the MCL. That's what I'm releasing now. And it's a distinct difference in the texture, the consistency, and the visual pattern of the fibers of MCL compared to the face fascia. You have to release it all the way to the back. Now, some people just cut it through, which is a perfectly fine. Turn my cochlea around now and release the posterior medial quarter of the tibia. You're still very far away from the neurovascular structure here. There is nothing to worry at this juncture and stuff. The key step in the operation is to do the posterior dissection. That's where most knee surgeons are afraid to do. Now, you need a good periosteum elevator such as this. This is the third periosteum elevator, which goes all the way to the back of the tibia, and you should be hitting the fibula head. They're releasing everything from back of the tibia all the way to the fibula head. And this is scraping the back of the tibia, so popliteus, everything on the back of the tibia, ideally subperiosteum is released. Once you've done that, same is done anteriorly, you need to isolate the patellar tendon. So my assistants are holding the patellar, showing me the patellar tendon and taking the fat and the skin up. And I can see the line, the medial margin of the patellar tendon. And I'm just releasing it with my seizure so that I can generate the space between the patellar tendon and the anterior tibia. And once you've got that, you just put a standard small Bowman retractor there. Now that you have done your anterior and posterior release, you are more or less set to decide how to cut or where to cut the tibia. Now it essentially depends on the kind of plate you're going to use. I'm showing you an osteotomy with a plate now. So you roughly mark the level of the face anterior, the semitographic tendon insertion on the tibia. That usually corresponds to starting point. The system I'm using here is useless, which is a different kind of plate, and the osteotomy is slightly proximal. So this is a slightly proximal osteotomy as compared to normal tomotic therapy plate osteotomy. I use all three plates, so there is no specific reason to use this plate apart from smaller correction and less invasive surgery. So you can use the surgery for small incisions. So once I put the plate, I now know where my osteotomy is going to be. So I just take a marking pen and mark my osteotomy where I'm going to do the osteotomy. Now these plates are L-shaped plates, and they come as a normal L or a reverse L based on whether you want to do just an HTO or whether you want to do a HTO combined with HTL reconstruction, where you can use a different kind of plate. And the central proximal hole has a swivel, so you can move it around whichever direction you want. It allows you to play with your screw trajectory to do any concurrent root there or a ACL reconstruction. So that's my position of osteotomy as marked with the plate. I'll pass a guide wire from that point to the lateral side, aiming for the head of the fibula. So once you pass the first wire, have a quick shoot to see that you got a good position. As you can see, you're trying to go for the head of the fibula, tip of the head of the fibula. What I normally tell everyone is you should be proximal to this line. So you should be proximal to this part anytime in the osteotomy and distal to the fibula head. So this is the error of margin for your exit point on the lateral side. Now your hinge point is about 5 millimeters short of this. So your hinge point is somewhere here or somewhere here. So that's what I'm aiming for. Now, as you start doing this regularly, it becomes a fairly standard thing to pass another guide wire perfectly parallel to the first wire. I'm not worrying about the slope at this juncture. Now, we'll talk about slope in a few minutes. So once you pass the guide wires, then comes the time when you start using your saw. Now, if you see, there's a big bad Hohmann retractor on the back here that is protecting the posterior neurovascular structure, because if you look carefully, look at the amount of toggle that's happening in the structure. Look at the amount of toggle that's happening on the blade. So it can easily damage the posterior neurovascular structure. So make sure you don't damage them by putting a big Hohmann on the back. So your blade actually is hitting the Hohmann rather than anything else. And you can always check under C-arm that you've got the Hohmann all the way to the end of the osteotomy. So you are covered properly. And you need to make sure that you've got a good trajectory of the blade. So you can see that the K-wire on top and that the blade are going underneath. And you can stop somewhere in that region. That's the level of your obstacle. So that's cutting in progress. Now, normally the posterior lateral cortex is generally not cut. So you need to give it time and do the cut properly for the posterior part of the osteotomy. Otherwise, it will not open up. Now remember, we isolated the patellar tendon here. So what we're going to do is do the second osteotomy, or the biplanar osteotomy. And in this patient, when the correction is less than 10 millimeters, on pre-op planning, I normally do a proximal biplanar osteotomy, such as this, which is at about 110 degrees to the original osteotomy, going under the patellar tendon, coming out on the lateral side. Now, once you've done this, you are going to stack osteotomes. Osteotomes are essential if you want to open the osteotomy carefully without breaking the hinge on the lateral side. So you need, these are sharp osteotomes, and I think it's important to keep the Hohmann down there, because the tip of the osteotome, if you're hammering and if you lift or if you hammer slightly harder, can damage the neural structure. So it's important to keep the Hohmann on the back here and gradually tap your osteotomes. Now there are normally 3 or 4 osteotomes, or in some cases 5 osteotomes, which are smaller in size in terms of their width as the number progresses. But essentially, you put the biggest one first, the second one with the back to its counterpart, and gradually open the osteotomy. That's a very elegant way of opening the osteotomy. I only use it if I'm worried my osteotomy is not opening very quickly. And that happens in bone which is too strong and not osteoporotic, like standard 45-50-year-old ladies who have a bit of osteoporosis. So this patient, the bone is quite strong. So I'm taking my time and I'm pushing the osteotomes all the way in. Now they should stop. The first one should stop at the hinge point. The second one should be about 3 to 4 millimeters short. And in succession, you can have a picture such as this. That's your osteotomy done. And once you stack the osteotomes, that's the first one is the longest, the second one is short by 3 to 4 millimeters, and the third one is between. We are opening it gradually here to give you a good correction, as you can see. Now, as I was saying, it's normally the posterior part which is not completely cleared, and that stops you from opening the osteotomy. So, till the time you are not able to open and close the osteotomy comfortably, make sure you have opened it and don't force the osteotomy open. Let the bone absorb the forces that you're putting in. I normally just put an osteotome to open the osteotomy like a wedge, and then put my laminar threader in the gap that I've created to open the osteotomy. So this is slightly fiddly on this because I'm struggling, but as you can see, that the osteotomy opened up. Now the intended correction was about 7 millimeters, and that's how the osteotomy should look. Now, if you can look, that's a nice trapezoidal gap. The laminar thread is placed on the posterior part. I have created a trapezoidal osteotomy like that, and not a rectangular osteotomy. So I'm maintaining the slope as it is by doing this. Now, again, next step is to confirm that you have got a good alignment. Now, for those of you who are doing a preoperative good planning may want to skip this step, but my advice is to do this, because every time you learn something new and you realize soft tissue injuries have changed the correction slightly. Now, this was about midpoint. I wanted to go somewhere more laterally to the lateral tibial spine. So I opened it a bit more to come to the lateral tibial spine, which corresponds to about 65-67% on the mucosal spine. That's my intended correction in this patient. So once I'm happy with that, change the center of the ankle and the knee joint without changing the position of the rod. Now I've placed the plate to confirm my position is still right, and if anything needs to be changed, as you can see, that's a pretty good position. I'm happy with that. Now all that matters now is just filling the hole. You can change the trajectory of the central screw either anteriorly or posteriorly. Generally speaking, the screws are directed posteriorly, but you can change the central screw slightly more and make it the maximum length possible. I usually hold it with a couple of K-wires to secure the plate and make sure the plate doesn't come up anteriorly. If you're putting a bone graft, then the osteotomy is pretty secure and you can take that laminar spreader off. But generally, if you're careful, the osteotomy correction does not move. So you have a good assistant who will not move the knee or will not move the leg while you're fixing the osteotomy, and a good laminar spreader or bone block or bone graft, which is holding the osteotomy open to the intended correction for you. Now, these are all torque-controlled screws. So you wait till the screwdriver clicks, and then you stop that. You don't try to over-tighten this. This system, unfortunately, has a slightly higher tendency of cold welding if you are not careful and not if you don't use the torque wrench. So it's just a matter of filling the screws. The three screws. I'm just filling the screws as we speak now. Just fast forward it. So now that you have fixed all the screws, you got a really secure fixation. You don't need to make another incision. The whole thing can be done through a small 4 or 5 centimeter incision. Now, as I said, various incisions have been practiced. When I was trained a good 15 odd years back, I was told that an oblique incision is the right incision for osteotomy. And indeed, I did that for a good few years. That I used to do a launching incision and then an oblique incision and a launching incision together. But then when you're struggling, you tend to increase the size of the incision, and sometimes you don't realize that you have done a big cut such as this, which is not an ideal cut. So you need to be careful. Presently, my incision of choice is this, but any incision that you're comfortable with works in my opinion. Now, there was a good question about slope change. I think as long as you have a good trapezoidal gap, you're not changing the slope significantly. Of course, this is a very crude way. If you want to be certain, you can put a couple of parallel K wires, one here and one here, which are parallel to begin with, and make sure that they are parallel even after opening the osteotomy to make sure that you haven't changed the slope at all. You can also physically measure the slope when you're opening the osteotomy by doing a lateral view and comparing it to the preoperative view. But if you are doing a standard osteotomy for intact cruciate, I don't think there's much to worry. So this was the case I showed. You can keep open much more posteriorly, less anteriorly, and if you can assess the slope here, it's nice neutral slope as was before in this session. Now, a very important point that most people ask is the hinge protection. If you're hitting for the right spot, which is between the fibula head and this line, then you have a less chance of hinge propagating or hinge cracking, because this part of the bone is well supported by a very strong ligament to support the proximal tibial fibula joint. And you can indeed play with the osteotomy such as this when under CRM control, when you're opening and closing the osteotomy, you can actually assess that the osteotomy is stable and the hinge is not opening up as we see in this image I'm showing. Now, I have started doing hinge pins for complex osteotomies or when my correction is beyond 10 millimeters. Now in this patient, this hinge pin is passed, and all it does is it allows the forces to be dissipated evenly without cracking the hinge. So you can easily play with your osteotomy here. So you can open and close your osteotomy and the vision, and you can see the osteotomy is not propagating proximally, laterally or inferiorly, so there's no chance of passage of practice. So you can indeed use this pin. It increases the time slightly and your opening is slightly takes slightly longer, but it's all right. Correction level is something which we have talked for many, many years. Now, as long as you are in vulgar zone, I think that's a good result. The Fujisawa point, which is actually a misnomer, which is about 67% innocent, is too far a correction. 62.5 is a decent correction. I normally go to 55 to 67%. My internal correction is always between 55 and 60. This is for a simple reason that most patients feel the legs have become more crooked or more deformed. If you do a significant correction, I know a lot of you won't agree with me, but I have stuck to my lateral procedures fine as a landmark and have had really good results with this landmark as the point of intended correction. Now, whether to put a bone graft or not is entirely up to you. What I like to do is I take a femoral head and cut it to my intended correction. So that's my 12 millimeter correction that I have done. Sorry, not degrees, millimeter correction that I have done. And I bash it into the osteotomy. Now, if you look carefully, it's trapezoidal width, so it's bigger posteriorly, smaller anteriorly, and I'm tapping it while my assistant is supporting the lateral hinge. My laminar spread is in situ supporting the osteotomy. And the moment you have done this, you will find that the osteotomy becomes super stable. You can even move the leg up and down without any issue because it's a very stable position of the leg. Now, if you are too tired or if you're very oversized, you can obviously cut the bone and put the plate on top. But that gives a really good correction, stabilization for your osteotomy. Now, you can use water, plate, 15 you want. I use all three of these routinely in my practice. So smaller osteotomies, I think you can use a smaller plate. Bigger osteotomies, you can use standard plates. And complex osteotomies, I think Tomofix is the only good plate in my opinion for complex intra-articular osteotomies or slope changing osteotomies, or whether you're doing something more than simple osteotomy in patients. What's important is to use the locking system and to get a secure fixation. I normally put bone graft for anything over 10 millimeters of correction, but I don't for under 10 millimeters correction. This was the final X-ray for the same patient for entering the main here. But this was the final X-ray for this patient. Now that her sitting cross-legged at 60, of course it's not important to sit cross-legged for most patients nowadays, but we have stuck to the tradition of showing patients sitting cross-legged. We like to show that. Now, this is 6 weeks after the surgery. She's able to walk fairly independently. The operated leg is quite nice and larger. The other leg is quite significant here, but she's quite happy with the fixation. I did her other side 3 months later with very good results. That's a very good, small, nicely healed scar. So, osteotomy as such is a very rewarding surgery for most patients. With, if you follow the set sequence of steps and take proper precautions, you generally be successful in this surgery. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhushan, for excellent talk. Sudeep, do we have any question?
Sir, we have a question from YouTube, may I?
Yeah, yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah, this is a question from Dr. Krishna Chaitanya to Clement, sir. How do you offload knee pre-op while assessing for STO? Okay, Clement, sir.
Before STO?
Yeah, yes, sir. Patient is still deciding for surgery and wants something to
be done. We used one of the two braces. One is called a freestyle from Brig and one more from Don Joy. I keep a few of them at hand in my clinic and hospital because we use them for conservative treatment. They have placed some of the braces. So I apply them to the. Sometimes they use it for half an hour and come back. You can actually see that their walking speed has increased, the pain has come down. They can give an immediate feedback. If still we have some doubt, maybe if the patient is a bit more elderly, I ask them to use it for a couple of weeks or even a month, and then they come back with the feedback. If they are having improvement with the brace, that is a good indication that they will do much better with an osteotomy, because osteotomy is going to result in a very in a better correction and predictable unloading. So I think if you are very serious about it, you can have some of the braces, the standard sizes available at your clinic, and you can ask them to use it for an hour, half an hour or so, walk around your place, and then they can ask for, you can ask for immediate feedback. If you ask them to buy, probably they may not buy because it's expensive, 20,000, 25,000.
So, Bhushan, so The Synthes system has a device where you can gradually open up your osteotomy. You don't use that?
I generally don't use that device. I don't have anything against it. It's a good device, but I like to use my laminar flow to open the osteotomy.
Yeah, so this is kind of useful because you can just screw in and dial in your correction gradually. And the next thing is you then replace it with a laminar spreader when you do the plate, because this obviously takes too much space. So you get the correction, you work it out. It just works because you can correct it very gradually and you have less chances of then having the lateral side breaking out when you're trying to correct
that's
it.
The device only
you can do without it, it's good. It's just a useful device for people who are starting out to do this.
But that's patented with Synthes and it's not available in other systems.
Your sound is not great.
Some sound issue is there, Bhushan. I think it's cracking. Yeah.
So it's available only with the Synthes system and it's not available for other plate systems. So it's a very good device. You can use a screwdriver to gradually open it and it's a very useful device. I agree entirely.
Sudeep, you want to add something?
No, I just want to, there was a question on WhatsApp that Bhushan has said that his bone graft, so the question is about bone graft, I'm slightly modifying it, that whenever his opening is more than 10 mm or 1 centimeter, he is using the bone graft. So it's question to all the speakers today is that what is their indication of bone graft? And I think Bhushan is using allograft, which is available to him. What are the other grafts that they are filling their defect with? So one by one, John sir, if you can start.
John sir, for my opening wedge osteotomies for osteoarthritis, we have not used bone graft. Full stop. So up to
I have never used bone graft for even for the 15 millimeter.
So we've done up to 17, 18 millimeters of correction. When you're going above 13, 14 degrees, we slope our osteotomy. The oblique cut is downwards rather than upwards so that you don't displace the patella, this thing, you don't affect the patella height too much. We haven't used bone graft. For our post-traumatic ones, we tend to use bone graft. I'm not sure whether we have to, but I'm just a little more worried about them. But for these medial compartment osteoarthritis, we have not. The only thing we do sometimes, which is a very useful thing to do, is if you have a lot of osteophytes on the medial side, we actually do an arthrotomy. We nibble out the osteophytes and put it into the gap. So that we do in maybe about 10% of the cases where we are doing it for slightly more advanced, not the ideal indications for HTO. And it's amazing how quickly bone forms when you do that. Okay, it's actually interesting. And this is, again, something which has been worn out by other authors, is these osteophytes, I don't know whether they have BMP or what in them, but it seems to heal up much quicker. So if we have a lot of osteophytes on the medial side, the femur, patella, we nibble out those osteophytes and put it into the osteotomy. But we have never used graft so far.
There's a paper from Japan, John, which has looked at this versus this allograft and substitutes. And they found that this is very, very fast.
It's really,
so I do exactly the same. Whenever, if I'm doing a double osteotomy, I take the wedge that I've taken out from the femur and put it into the tibia.
Yeah, that's.
But otherwise, when doing a tomofix, I don't put in a.
I'm not putting graft. A graft in more than 100 cases now.
Clement, sir, your take on this?
Yeah, I don't routinely do bone grafting, but in osteoporotic bone, women above 55, sometimes I use a tricalcium phosphate wedge.
Not used anything so far.
No.
Rajiv.
Manish, you want to add something? Yeah, Manish was asking.
Well, I don't want to add something. In the technique Dr. Bhushan was showing, you had used the implant as a template for assessing the point, starting point for osteotomy. Are there any other methods apart from the implant being used as a template to decide what is the starting point of the osteotomy, the transverse osteotomy?
So we go by the Pes anserinus, okay? So we need to go just above that. So we go as distal as possible where we can avoid damaging the pes anserinus, basically.
But one more point to be remembered is if you are using the tomofix, Indian ladies are quite small. And the distance to that third screw, if you need to have four screws in the proximal fragment. So I will often use what Bhushan talked about. I'll keep the plate there, and then I will find that in some patients, I need to do the osteotomy lower. Otherwise, I will get only 3 screws. So there, I will do a little bit of a release of the pest.
So
that my osteotomy will go lower and I can get 4 screws, because I think the tomofix depends on all 4 screws in the proximal fragment.
Yeah. So,
and that's one more thing to remember about what, meaning people shouldn't mix up what we are talking and what Bhushan has talked about, especially about the plate that he showed. What's the name of that, Bhushan? I forgot. The thinner plate which you use, it depends also on some internal stability, right? So you should always use a graft with the plate that he showed. But with the tomofix, you can get away. So we should not get confused that, oh, Bhushan said use a graft and we are saying don't use a graft. But if you are using, if I have to use that plate, I will still use a graph, because the strength of those plates are different.
Absolutely. So
it's not imperfect.
Bhushan, your voice is sound is really bad. I don't know
something.
I think
for the juniors, if you remember that if you are more or less 4 centimeter away from the medial joint line, most of the time you are correct for the tomofix. You all great all 4 screws for the tomofix.
And now there's an Asia Pacific plate, which is a
available
profile and takes a little less space. That's the other good thing about that.
But the distance of your osteotomy from the joint line will still be the same.
Yeah, but
low profile it is, but your you can still have, I've still run into situations where above the pes anserinus, I may not get 4 screws. So I will do a little bit of a release and go a little distal. In women,
okay. Especially short stature.
I agree, but we've not had to do that so far. When you say release, I don't mean we do retract it as much as possible, but we don't divide it or anything like that. So yes, you do.
No, I mean incise the upper edge so that I can move my osteotomy a little lower down.
So we just undermine it a little bit and retract it, and we've been able to get 4 screws. Okay. It's interesting that the screw that is, that means the 4th screw is actually quite oblique. So as long as you're just above the osteotomy, it seems to miss the osteotomy altogether. You think it's going to go straight into the osteotomy, but it goes above it. I don't know. The design is such that it seems to, you just need to be just above the osteotomy.
Obviously. Yes, Sudeep. Yeah, 3 questions have come up quickly before we move on to the next talk. One is for Clement, sir. And the question is that when... how would you decide, once again, actually, I think people want to know when to do a double osteotomy. Do you do it at the same sitting or in a different sitting? That's one for you. And for Bhushan, what's your post-op protocol after osteotomies, like weight pairing and other things? So these are the 2 questions that have come up.
So if I may start, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, Bhushan. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
I unplugged my earphone. It's directed off into laptop. Hopefully that works. So yeah, what I'm saying is that if you have a good secure fixation, and in my case, if I bone grafted, I allow them weight bearing as tolerated fairly immediately. So most patients are encouraged to weight bear as tolerated because of soft tissue injury and during the surgery and the pain that they have. They usually prefer to walk with a walker or a stick for first week or so. But most patients are walking almost full weight bearing in 15 days at the time of suture removal. Of course, it depends on the patient's knee condition, the bone osteoporosity, and how good a fixation you have achieved. But they can easily take full weight of the patient even if they do start walking sooner. So I don't stop them from walking. But I tell them, go as your pain allows you to walk.
Anything different from other faculty members on this before we go to Clement, sir, for his response?
So we mobilize them with a walker, partial weight bearing, by 3 weeks, they're almost full weight bearing. That's the usual thing. So even with bilateral, where we've done bilateral osteotomies, we've got them up there. We have to be a little more careful. So they are kind of holding on to the walker and it's in a way partial weight bearing on each side if it's possible, but we get them up using a walker even when we've done bilateral osteotomies. As long as you're happy with your hold, okay? So if you have a situation where you're unhappy with your fixation, then everything changes, whatever reason.
Any, Clement sir, your question now about double osteotomy. You're not audible right now.
Clement sir, there's some audio issue here.
No.
Not audible here.
So can I just comment on that? Because I think your double osteotomy has to be based on your planning. And I think Mangal will go. So some of these have a femoral as well as a tibial deformity. And you get that zigzag deformity if you do it on one side and the deformity is on both sides. Okay, so most of the double osteotomies for me would be if there's a femoral as well as a tibial, rather than just purely on the magnitude of the deformity.
Yeah,
I think so.
LDFA more than 90.
Yeah.
Varus crust. They are so. And what kind of ticks you off or warns you about an LDFA more than 90 is if you see that the patient has a varus crust, then you got to double check. So then those patients you definitely should do a full length X-ray because they will have a significant amount of soft tissue laxity also. So you correct the femoral deformity in the femur and correct the tibial deformity in the tibia. That what Clement was referring to about MPTA more than 95 happens when you try to compensate for the femoral deformity on in the tibia, either knowingly or unknowingly.
Karnando, you are adding something here.
No. I think the question, Sudeep, the guy who is asking about the double osteotomy for the femur or tibia or the oblique osteotomy for the patellar side they are doing.
No, it was about
for femur.
No, both. Double osteotomy means femur and tibia.
Femur and tibia they are asking. Okay, then I think Mangal has answered the question. Okay.
Yes.
So we can move ahead with the third one. I think Mangal, here now it's your turn.
Yeah.
Only interesting thing about the bone graft use in high tibial osteotomy. So people has used both with the short strut and the long strut like Tomofix and both autograft also and this tricalcium phosphate also. The interesting thing is that if you use tricalcium phosphate, the stability will be highest, but the chances of non-union is maximum with tricalcium phosphate. That is not with the autograft or allograft. Thank you.
Your slide is visible, okay, sir. Yeah, it's on the screen.
All right. So I'm just going to show you. I continue to use. I started off, even before the Tomofix was available, I used to do high tibial osteotomies almost from the time I finished my fellowship. Earlier, we used to use ring fixators, and then when the Orthofix was available, we started using the Orthofix. Then the Tomofix and other plates have come in. I use them quite a bit, but still, it's only 20% of the work. And I'll show you a couple of cases why, because I find it much easier with a fixator. So this 66-year-old lady with significant varus, arthritic changes, somebody was asking about patellofemoral. So the X-ray shows, but she didn't have any real knee pain. All her pain was localized on the medial knee joint. And now here, if you see, if we draw her angles, you will find that there is an increased angle over here. I think in her planning, we will have it. And she has this lateral thrust. So if there is a lateral thrust and there is if there is femoral varus, then they need to have a femoral osteotomy. So in this particular case, we will do a double osteotomy. What I use really to decide is an MRI to confirm that the lateral compartment cartilage is okay. I use a valgus stress view to see that the medial joint line opens up. Patient has to be an active person, poor candidate for a TKR in other situations in terms of, say rural background, et cetera, et cetera. Age is not necessarily a factor for my decision. So here, even though on the standing view, you can see that the joint space is grossly reduced. On a valgus stress view, you can see that the medial side opens out the moment the load goes onto the lateral side. And this is also useful to explain to patients that, you know, how the concept of how that unloading works. Now, in her case, her LDFA was 94. So we decided that she will need a osteotomy of the femur as well as of the tibia. Now, on the femur, because it's well closed with muscle and it's a closing wedge osteotomy, doing a distal femoral closing wedge is really a piece of cake, one of the best surgeries I think ever devised, because it is so stable that patients get going right away. So there we use a plate, but for the tibia, we use, normally I use a fixator. For this lady, we use a plate because she was older. So this is a standard distal femoral closing wedge, which is also biplanar, just like described for the tibia. And once this closes, you really can't see the osteotomy, stable as hell. And once that is done, the alignment has improved. Okay, it was way onto the medial side. Now it's come closer to the center. So now we need to do the opening wedge. So here, we keep this wire in. Now, as Bhushan described, I also use this hinge wire if required. But with this amount of opening out, you can see that the alignment rod is going to the base of the lateral tibial spine, which is where I want it. Basically, that gives us an angle of 185, 183 to 186, and mechanical axis deviation of somewhere between 62 to 67. In this particular case, because I had done a femoral osteotomy also, I put in that graft into that gap, and that's her post-op x-ray. But when I do the full-length x-ray, surprise, surprise, this comes more than what I had seen on table. And I do everything that has been talked in the technique, axial pressure to simulate weight bearing, etc., and ensure that I use the alignment rod, etc. However, this was the amount of mechanical axis deviation that I got. And also, if you notice here, this is more than 186 degrees, the HKA. Patient is doing perfectly fine, but this is a worry that I am not able to correct it as accurately as I would like. So that's her clinical pictures. Now with that, she's walking well. We've not done anything to the soft tissue. You can see her lateral thrust has gone away. And that's an important point, that for the so-called soft tissue laxity, as long as you get the loading onto the lateral side, they don't have any lateral laxity anymore. A similar case, older lady, I think she was 65. You can see her mechanical axis deviation, valgus stress, full length x-rays. We use the same way as Clement talked about to calculate the angle of correction. Sorry. And do this intra-op alignment with the thing spread open. One thing for everybody, I think, is that the cautery cord is not good enough. It kind of twists and moves quite a lot. So really what you should be using is the alignment rod in the set. So we first center it on the head, we center it on the ankle, and then bring the C-arm to the knee to look at it, right? So we do all of these things. We use the alignment rod, we use axial pressure, and aim somewhere for the base of the tibial spine. Now with this open as much, we put the plate in, right? So we did an HTO, open wedge, tomofix, and biplanar as described without any graft interposition. However, again, when we do the full length x-ray, we find that this is a little more onto the lateral side. And as Bhushan pointed out, patients don't like excessive valgus. So to me, it's important to be to, you know, between 183 to 185, because that is what really unloads the medial joint well. But I don't want, I don't like this going excessively lateral, you know. And this is probably the area which is kind of the unknown factor. You can never predict or precisely plan for this soft tissue. Some of them open up a lot. Some of them don't open up much. Now you see on table, she's opening out this much, but on the full length X-ray, you see here, she's not opening out that much. So what is that number that you need to take? So there is a number which they talk about, I think. So we use this, the angle of correction minus the soft tissue, that is the joint line convergence angle, this one, plus 3, which would be the normal joint line convergence angle. So if you see over here, the angle of correction was 15. And we subtracted 2.7 from it to get an angle of correction of 13. So we use that same method even for our Elisarov corrections, but somehow it's not that precise. Now what I do is with the fixator, I put on the fixator, I do my osteotomy distal to the tuberosity, but it is an oblique osteotomy similar to what the AO talks about. The tibial tuberosity will be somewhere over here. So I'm going distal, but my apex is at the same point that all of us talk about, somewhere around the tip of the fibula. Now, one advantage of this is, this does not affect the patellar height. This does not increase the patellofemoral pressure. Even in some of our patients who have significant metaphyseal varus, where you need to do large corrections, because you are distal to the tuberosity, you are not affecting the patellofemoral contact stress. So it is distal to the tuberosity, but it's not complete. And it is aiming right for the tip of the fibula with an intact lateral hinge. So this is a comparison of the blue, which is what most people talk about for a biplanar osteotomy. And the AO guys talk about it. And this is what I do, which is slightly distal, so that the tuberosity goes into the proximal fragment, but the obliquity is the same and the ending of it on the tip of the fibula is the same. So once I have completed my osteotomy, it is a complete osteotomy in the sense that it allows for opening out, but it is incomplete in the sense that the lateral hinge is intact. So I can use a frame, fixator, which is very, very relatively low profile because there is an inherent stability in the system, right? And we close it down. And then after 7 days, we start this distraction. Now, the important thing here is for all patients, we calculate what is the angle of correction, just like we calculate for the tomofix. Why do we do that? Because we want patients to come back after X number of days so that we can do a full length X-ray. I don't want to do full length X-rays repeatedly. I want to do it on one particular day so that I know that, okay, now this angle has come to absolutely correct, right? So this plan, our Elisarov plan, the fixator planning also takes the abnormal JLCA into account. And here, from this apex, we've calculated 13.1. And on the fixator, how much distraction will happen using the magnification that Clement talked about. So our numbers are real world. They are not going to go wrong by magnification, etc. So 21 days of distraction is what we calculate for this particular patient. And I would say about 8 times out of 10, we are perfect. But 2 times out of 10, we still have issues. So for this patient, we calculated 21 days. She came after 21 days of distraction, and her mechanical axis was way onto the lateral side. So mechanical axis deviation was much more than what we wanted. So because we have a fixator, we can calculate, okay, so many days of distraction resulted in so many, you know, so much overcorrection. So how much should we reduce it by? So here we have the desired MAD and the desired HKA. This is a simple Excel sheet. And we can subtract 5 days of distraction. That means turn the fixator in a reverse direction. Not for 5 days. This is done on the same day because distraction has to be gradual. Compression can be acute. So that means 5 days, meaning 5 millimeters of compression. So that's her at 2 millimeters of compression. That's her at 4 millimeters of compression, right? And she goes to 185.5 based on that. So that's the preoperative, post correction after we have planned properly, then 2 days, 2 millimeters of compression, and then final another 2 millimeters of compression. So now I've got the manacle axis exactly where I want it. And the fixator is locked at 185, and the net distraction so that she had was 17 days. So even with all the calculation, in a weight bearing situation, these things tend to change. So for me, that's why I use, in 80% of the cases, I use a fixator, because it allows me infinite correction. If I find that, okay, it's not good enough, patient can go on distracting for 2 days, 4 days more. And this is in a weight-bearing position, which never happens when you're doing a regular open wedge osteotomy with a plate. So I do use the Tomofix. I use it in older patients like the first one I showed you, because even if things go wrong or they don't, you know, the longevity of the relief is not there, they are in that age group where a knee replacement can be done. I cannot afford, according to me, that imprecision in 40-year-old. In a 40-year-old, I want it absolutely perfect. In a 60-year-old, it doesn't matter. 5 years, 6 years later, they start getting pain. They can go for a knee replacement. Patients who need a slope correction as well as angular correction, I can't use the fixator because it does not allow a change in the slope. So there, I will have to use a Tomofix. And finally, in younger patients, where I'm operating for a deformity and not for MCOA. So there, a little bit of undercorrection is tolerable because they are not patients for HTO or for medial compartment osteoarthritis. So that's the reasons why I use the fixator in preference to the plates in most of these cases for MCOA.
Thank you, Mangal. As usual, your talk is so lucid. No, I think we have understood every bit of it. And Mangal, you're the PowerPoint, the background, whatever we are seeing this for last 25 years, it has not been changed. That's great for you. Once this background, that white background with the yellow mark comes horizontally, we know that Mangal is presenting.
No reason to make fancy backgrounds. I mean, just, you know, as long as your content is okay, I think the backgrounds just distract.
Yeah, just for the sake of comment. Okay. John, anything to add on?
No, I think it's a very justifiable plan because it gives you the ability to correct post-operatively, which no other method, the Tomofix doesn't. So I think when you're doing the Tomofix, you have to be very careful that you don't overcorrect. And yes, there will be cases occasionally where you don't get exactly the correction you want. Fixator gives you the opportunity to readjust your correction post-operatively if you think it, if in your long leg x-rays you find there's a problem. Yeah. So that's an advantage.
Let me put a question to John, you, Bhushan, Arvind, anyone else who's doing osteotomies. When you all do full length x-rays after
every time
correction,
every time.
So how many times do you find that you have not achieved what you planned for?
It's interesting that we've not seen this huge lateral problem that you showed with your x-rays. We have had some cases which are not corrected as much as we wanted to. Yes, but we've not seen this huge lateral. Maybe because I don't aim for Fujisawa's point. I just get it just across the midline. So where you're almost parallel to, in line with the...
No, I understand. What I'm trying to ask is, you aimed for across the midline. And just then you, in the full length x-ray, you found that it is on the base of the lateral tibial spine. Or do you always... Meaning, explain to me why I have this trouble.
Well, that's what I'm trying to say.
Am I a bad surgeon?
No. It's, the thing is, I don't go... I never seem to go that far laterally. So my problems have been more of undercorrection. Yes.
I think Mangal, the main problem in the overcorrection is the soft ones. We don't decide the soft piece of component and we ignore the JCLA. These are the two main problems, yes, for the overcorrection. One is the soft tissue component, second is the JCLA. If you don't subtract your JCLA, you don't take the varus and valgus, you don't take the 76.4, that calculation for the JCLA, probably you will, every time you do that, you will find that overcorrection in your full length x-ray.
So we have...
Yeah, go on.
Maybe one out of three cases, we may go for undercorrection. Off late... I had two instances of a slight overcorrection, but they are all extensive lesions. What I want to ask you, sir, Dr. Parihar, is there any tip you can give us how you position the knee for when you do the long rod test? Yeah, how you get the proper images intraoperatively, whether the positioning of the leg during our surgery rotations can kind of give a false interpretation of our alignment. And then when you do the rod placement, do you also close the lateral joint so that you'll be able to compensate for the JLCA? Do you apply a varus?
So this is what Staubli and Loganhofer, both of them, talk about, is giving axial pressure on the heel with your tummy. So when you're giving axial pressure, essentially you're loading that limb and you're giving the appropriate amount of valgus stress. So I do that in all of them. As far as rotation goes, I ensure that the patella is central. I also use Staubli's sort of trick of cheap navigation, where first I put in a K wire at the beginning of the surgery, keep the patella central and put in a K wire so that it's absolutely vertical when you're looking at it from the end of the limb. Then if you keep that patella straight, you don't have to keep shooting again and again to ensure that your rotation is correct. Just visually looking at that wire will tell you that, yes, I am central. So I will do the x-rays, that is the planning, with patella forward, and I will do the surgery in patella forward, and I will do the check of the alignment also in the patella forward. Now, yes, can I be wrong by 1 or 2 degrees of rotation? Possibly. But I take every care to ensure that I am as straight as possible.
So, Mangal, what, I mean, I agree that your intraoperative assessment cannot be 100% perfect. So there will be some variations. What I find is that extreme lateral thing, we've not actually seen in all these cases that we've done. Okay, so we have, whenever we draw the joint line, it's been okay, or if anything, a little medial to what we would have really tried to achieve. So we've not...
It's the same thing. Because if it could be that if I say that I want to make a mistake, I will make a mistake slightly onto overcorrection side, and you may say that, okay, I may make a mistake slightly on the undercorrection side. Maybe that is the reason.
But
the point is that, you know, as Clement said, in 1 out of 3, you don't meet the goal. That means 25% of patients, if you believe the theory that accurate correction leads to the longest results, then 25% of patients on table, you are saying that, okay, these guys are not necessarily going to last that long.
No, I mean, so
that is my issue.
So we correct what we calculate preoperatively on standing films. Okay, so we try to get that angle in our correction, and with this device, you're able to actually measure what correction you're doing.
Yeah, I do that. That's what, no. So I calculate my my angle, all of it.
So I don't.
So I don't know. I'm still kind of looking for answers. If someone else has, Bhushan.
No.
I think Mangal, whatever you are calculating, as because your device is absolutely flexible. And you can basically, even if you overcorrect, still you can manage with the sort of compression on that. So that's the beauty of your external fixator sort of thing. Because once we are wrong on table, we cannot do anything other with the tomofix.
So he's trying to find out why he's going wrong.
Yeah.
Why? If I can get that accuracy with the tomofix, I'll shift to the tomofix tomorrow, or whatever other system. I mean, it's not related to this. I'm saying I will shift to acute cataplexy tomorrow.
Yeah. Is there any chance of intra-observer variations when you're assessing doing pre-op learning? And have you noticed using more than one technique for pre-op planning? For example, you do the sketching, then you do software, because we use 2-3 techniques. I'm actually thankful, Dr. Mangal, you have trained Dr. VSU Kumar very well, one of my colleagues. Even if I'm doing surgery, I'll forward the x-rays to him. The morning, he will send me the number of value. Sir, you have to correct 8 degree, 8 mm correction. My fellow also will work. And then I also work using a different software. Is there any way that if you happen to use a particular method on only one instance that you can get it wrong? Or should you use more than one technique, or should you use more than one observer for planning, pre-op planning?
No, actually the same thing happens with us also. In the sense, I do the planning, my associate Dr. Ahuja, Divya Ahuja, he does the planning, and the fellows do the planning. We do it either with there's a software which we are kind of helping to develop called TabPlan, or with it's a software, or we do it on the iPad. So the numbers have to match. They may be 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters, or 1 degree, 2 degrees here and there, but they can't be grossly off. And that's exactly what I'm saying, that 1 degree, the error of measurement, I put the point slightly this side, that side, that 1 degree will be there. I'm not complaining about 1 or 2 degrees. My issue is, despite being careful, I'm having it go otherwise. And the other thing which I pointed out, that even with the fixator, we plan the same way, and we plan for the patient, okay, you come back after 18 days of distraction. 8 times out of 10, when the patient comes after 18 days or whatever it is for that particular deformity, when the patient comes back, they have a perfect angle. But 2 times out of 10, they are, even with the fixator, they are not right. So it's not that the fixator is better in correction. It is, the issue is basically in the planning.
So is there a role for MCL release? Suppose if I have been very liberal with my MCL release, I also released a bit of deep MCL. Will that laxity contribute to the exaggerated valgus? Theoretically, I'm asking, sir.
I probably not. I mean, I also release it, but I have it okay in some, not, it's part, I think it's part of the procedure.
So
when you use the tomofix, you should release the MCL.
Yeah, but there's a extent to which you release it. Okay. So what we do is we release it, but we don't divide it. Okay. So there is, in fact, there's some people who actually divide the superficial medial collateral ligament as part of the procedure. We don't go all the way around to the back, as Bhushan showed, that we don't put our spike all the way laterally. What we make sure is we get enough space at the back on the medial side. So we just start our cut with the saw, and the rest of the cut we actually do with the osteotomes. Okay, so it's one by one, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we put one osteotome after the one chisel after the other. And usually four, they have now 5 in the set. We usually use 4. Then we kind of, by then it's loosened up, and then we put this device and really go very slowly in opening that up. Okay. In spite of all that, we've had 1 or 2 cracks going into the joint sometimes. That's something you have to be careful of. And obviously the lateral side, you have to be really careful. We've not had any occasion where we've had to augment the fixation on the lateral side through all these cases, because probably because we are really cautious about doing it. But I'm sure that can happen. It'll happen to me next time probably.
No, the other thing, John, is whenever you change the slope, you have to break the hinge.
Yeah, yeah. If you're deliberately changing the slope,
your hinge is broken. And with the Tomofix, so I've done that at least I think 6 times in terms of changing the slope, and couple of times where I've broken the lateral hinge inadvertently. But with the Tomofix, you use that, you know, yellow screw.
First screw, you have to pull it up and you can use it. Yeah.
So compress it.
So as long as you are just cracking it and not displacing it, you're okay.
As long as it's not intra-articular, you're good.
Yeah. Both of them. I mean, so if I find I'm getting a line going into the joint, I sometimes put a prophylactic screw across that while I'm doing it. Okay.
Breakage of lateral hinge is not very uncommon complication. Sometimes it occurs. So how often do you recommend of using a K-wire or a lateral prophylactic hinge screw for just preventing that breakage of the lateral hinge? John sir or Mangal sir?
So I haven't used it so far. So I can't. So I saw Bhushan's thing of putting a wire there. Something maybe we'll try, but we've not had to use it so far.
There are papers which say they are very good in prevention.
Yeah.
But as I said, I have not used them regularly. Now that this is coming out, I'm looking at it. But overall, what happens is with a certain amount of experience and you're going slowly, you know exactly where to stop. You don't make the mistake of going too much. So I would say for someone who's starting off, not a bad idea to put it in. Kya lagta hai?
I know it's a minor thing. Over there. So it may be worth doing.
It doesn't cost anything.
I think second important thing for beginners are for posterior cortex osteotomy, what precaution you take, and do you only use a lateral view for posterior cortical osteotomy, osteotomy of the posterior cortex?
So the
main thing is to make sure that you release the medial collateral off the bone and get your spike underneath when you cut, so that you have a distance between the soft tissue and the bone. Okay. And if you do that, it's like one of those things where you don't want to say that you haven't had the problem, but we've not had the problem so far. Okay. So we go there, and then we go with the with the chisels all the way. So make sure you cut across the medial cortex. That medial cortex is really thick. Okay. The
posterior medial,
posterior medial cortex. So you have to make sure you've cut that with the saw. Okay. And then
For the Tomofix, you have to use the saw.
Yeah.
You have to use
Start
the
with,
saw.
Yeah.
I do it with an osteotome because I'm doing it through a 10 millimeter incision, but I can feel actually. And you can actually come out and feel, okay, now I'm on the edge, and then go.
Yeah.
So I probably go earlier. I used to show people the lateral view of the C-arm, where I would place the osteotome and then switch the C-arm into lateral and show that the osteotome is only about 2-3 millimeters beyond. Mm-hmm. I would always raise the periosteum below and move that in a sideswipe manner so that whatever soft tissue is there has fallen behind. But for the Tomofix, I think what Bhushan talked about, you know, putting a good retractor and ensuring, because you are using a saw there.
Yes.
And some of these original guys, they use something known as a precision saw, where only the tip of the saw moves. Yes. The saw we are using is oscillating. That saw touches anywhere, it jumps. So you have to be sure that you're well protected.
Yeah, I don't cut all the way with the saw as Bhushan does. I just cut the medial cortex, posteromedial cortex with the saw. The rest I do with the osteotome. So I don't release all the way across the popliteus to the lateral side.
But this is John Mukhopadhyay.
Yeah.
He can do it. No, I'm telling you. No, it is true. It's true. No, see, because the original technique talks about using the saw. If you use an osteotome on the posterior cortex, there is a higher risk of shattering and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yes. Right.
So he is a person who can feel. I mean, you know, once you are doing something multiple times, you can feel how your osteotome is going. He can feel it. The guy who's starting off may not be able to judge it that way.
No, I'm not trying to say no. I think Bhushan, certainly, if I was going to cut all the way with a saw, I would release it all the way and put a spike all the way across. Mm-hmm. Since I'm not cutting all the way with the saw, I don't do it.
Also, Rajiv sir, you can get confirmed by your naked eye when you are doing tomofix and cutting with the saw. After releasing the periosteum and MCL, you can literally see whether you're
correct
or it has cut. So no need to check with lateral X-ray.
Just see there.
Yeah, you have to make sure that it's cut, and only then will your chisel actually cut through that part. Otherwise, it's just going to struggle. Okay.
And
Mangal sir.
Yeah.
I usually use Bone Ninja app in iPads because it automatically calculates all these angles, MIDA, LDFA and all. Sir, pre-op and post of both. What is your take on that, sir, on Bone Ninja?
Bone Ninja is good enough, but it's good enough for sort of what we call back of the paper calculation. Precision-wise, it's a little less because you're working at a lesser magnification. So when we are using TraumaCAD, for example, I'm using it on a big computer screen. I can zoom into that area much easily. So in the absence of anything else, Bone Ninja is good. But you have to be sure that you are precise in terms of the calculation. I think it's a good thing to use.
Okay, I think
any question on YouTube?
I have a question from YouTube. Krishna Chaitanya is asking, sir, when do you choose biplanar osteotomy in tibia side?
Always.
Because the funda is that the vertical limb imparts a rotational stability. Also, that's an area which is in contact. Even if you distract, the vertical limb is in contact, so it heals quicker. So if at all, the only issue would be when you're doing large corrections where they say that instead of moving the limb up, you can move the limb downwards. But otherwise, I would say almost always biplanar. Very small patient, haddi is very thin. Technically, it's difficult to do. Maybe I wouldn't. But otherwise, I will always do a biplane. I think everybody agrees with that, right?
Yeah, and the idea is that your vertical limb is a complete osteotomy, while your oblique one, which goes across to the lateral cortex,
is the partial,
is an incomplete osteotomy. Okay.
Yeah. So I think, Samsul, if there is no question, we can move on.
Mangal sir, one thing about overcorrection and undercorrection. Will the difference between supine X-ray and standing X-ray calculation of angle of correction, a large difference will give a indication that there might be a chance of overcorrection or undercorrection more?
I have not looked at it that way, but one of the issues is that in a supine X-ray, it's difficult to get a full length X-ray.
A stitch X-ray?
So you will be looking only at a spot film. Then if you look at a spot film, you are missing other things like say a little bit of femoral bowing, maybe, you know, a little bit of proximal hip varus. Those things then don't come into the picture. But maybe overall, yes, there is a difference.
Maybe navigation.
Sorry, John, what?
I'm just saying maybe navigation may be an answer in the future if you can actually navigate and look at your life.
I have looked at the literature on that.
It's not yet that accurate. But I'm saying in the future, maybe we can get a.
Yeah.
Well, if our standing angle of correction is very much more, there is a large difference between a standing x-ray with a calculating angle of correction and the supine x-ray, then there might be a chance that the ligament is so much lax that we might go into overcorrection or undercorrection.
No, but ligament lax hai ki nahi. I do my valgus stress view and my varus stress view and I know even otherwise. That is a supine x-ray. So I'm getting that number and I'm using that number. Matlab, joint plank convergence angle hai 7 degrees. That means there is 7 degrees soft tissue component. Normal joint line angle is 2 degrees or 3 degrees. So if the angle of correction I get is 20, let us say. I don't correct for 20 degrees varus. I correct for 20 minus 7, 13 plus 3, 16. So my calculation of all the wedge, etc., all of us do it the same way, is based on that. You get the point. So we are already factoring in the soft tissue component.
Yeah, and anyway, you correct based on your long limb standing x-rays. So you should not get, if you're doing it on that and you do that, you should not ideally get a huge overcorrection, but there must be, obviously, the what we measure intraoperatively is not.
Anyway, these meetings will continue. We'll keep
stimulate us to keep talking about it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, I think now it's Dr. John Mukhopadhyay's turn. He is going to talk on the intra-articular osteotomy of proximal tibia.
Okay, is that the screen visible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I think unfortunately these are basically malunions after intra-articular fractures, which we unfortunately still have to deal with, and we can get them with patients who've been operated on or treated conservatively. And really, traditionally, we had very few good solutions for it. It included sort of analgesics, physiotherapy, intra-articular injections, and eventually either an arthrodesis or an arthroplasty. So it was a question of what we can do, especially for the major intra-articular problems, whether there was something we could do for them. And it's interesting that I think one of the things which I learned about it was in a talk by Professor Rene Marti many years ago in the IOA meeting in Delhi, which was held in Ashoka Hotel. I remember it was early in the morning, 8 o'clock talk. This was in a huge hall with about 5 or 6 people attending, and he gave his sort of talk on these intra-articular osteotomies of the proximal tibia, and it was a real eye-opener for me in those days. And then obviously I then went on and developed an interest in it, and I'll show you some of my experience in it. And I think you need to assess these patients clinically in terms of their symptoms, disability, instability, and range of motion before any decision on surgery, and obviously radiologically. And you've heard of all the radiological things that you need to look at in the earlier talks, but here you would also need to do a CT to look at the intra-articular step-offs and depressions, etc. So I think CT is an essential part of your assessment for these intra-articular malunions. Now, your treatment strategies could vary. There will be some intra-articular malunions which you can treat with just an extra-articular osteotomy if the intra-articular problem is minimal. You may have to do combined intra-articular and extra-articular osteotomies. You may have to do intra-articular osteotomies with plateau hemi elevation. You may have to elevate depressed segments. Sometimes the depression may not involve the entire condyle and just part of the condyle. So you can't elevate the entire condyle in those situations. And then you have certain situations where you may have to do complex reconstructions along with sometimes even ligamentous reconstructions to deal with the patient. So I think let's just start with some relatively simpler cases and go on to slightly more complex cases. This is a young gentleman around 30 who had an injury a year ago, and you can see that he's got a deformity in the proximal tibia with the intra-articular depression involving the medial condyle extending to slightly into the lateral condyle. So you need to plan your deformity, you need to plan your osteotomy. So your osteotomy will be in the more or less in the direction of the fracture, going to just below the articular cartilage, and then you have to hinge open that area. So that's what you do. Your osteotomy is going there, you elevate it and then put in bone graft in these situations, and then we fixed it with a medial plate. This is a locking plate, but not the Tomofix. This is a conventional locking teak plate, which was available earlier. It's still available. These flat ones are still available. The ones for the proximal tibial fractures are apparently no longer available. This is his follow-up, and you can see his long limb alignment x-rays have also improved. It's similar to what it is on the opposite side. He's got a bit of constitutional varus, and this is him at 1 year follow-up. You can see both the limbs look pretty equal in terms of the alignment, and he's got a full range of motion and is able to squat and do his normal day-to-day activities. So that was a hemi-plateau elevation. You can get depressed segments. Now, in this case, if you look at this carefully, you know this patient was actually referred to me as a ligamentous instability because she had valgus instability in the knee. And again, if you look at the x-rays and the CT scans, you can see that the depression is more on the posterolateral corner here. So it kind of slopes abnormally on the lateral side. So you can't just elevate this entire thing. You need to elevate it more posteriorly than anteriorly. Okay, so first is how to find access. So you can see the rim here, peripheral rim here is intact. So you need to do, you can do an osteotomy through that rims, which will give you access directly onto the joint to look at the, you do a submeniscal arthrotomy, of course, and that's the sutures on the meniscus. Here's the depression. You recreate the fracture with this osteotome with a good significant subchondral bone. You elevate it here. You can use bone graft or bone substitute. You can see how we've elevated it, put the wire. We tend to drive this wire right across from the other side so that it doesn't get in the way of our plating. As you can see here, this wire right across. You put in your bone substitute or bone graft, and then you fix it with a plate. So that's the bone substitute and the fixing with a plate. And that's the postoperative x-ray showing a decent correction of it. This is her 1 year post-op. She is now stable and has got a good correction and a good function. Similarly, you can have a posteromedial condyle depression. This is not a very uncommon thing to which we find missed quite often, either isolated or in combination with a bicondylar fracture. And you can see this huge double shadow here. So in this case, it's a pretty significant step off. Okay, and again, you do your CT scans. You can see the posteromedial depression here. Again, on this X, on the lateral view, you can see this huge step off in the subluxation of the joint here. So here you'll have to plan your osteotomy again through this area where the original fracture was. Here we went through a posterior approach. This was the image before we did our osteotomy. You do your osteotomy again through the Lobenhofer approach. You do your osteotomy and elevate this hemi. So this side, the posteromedial segment up. And here now you can see how this double shadow has been corrected. And at this stage, you can drive in a lag screw and then a buttress plate and bone graft the gap if you feel it's necessary. So that's a lag screw holding that, then a buttress plate. And this is a post-op x-ray at about 5 months. And this is at 18 months post-op, again, showing a good correction with the joint well seated. And again, so you can see that there's no double shadow on the medial side here. We were able to get a very accurate correction. I can't say we get it every time exactly right. There's sometimes still a slight double shadow, but that's a huge depression. If you can even correct it to 80 to 90%, it is better than leaving it in that situation. So coming to more complex problems, this is a 54-year-old gentleman with a six-month-old injury. So he's got multiple problems here. You can see this depressed segment, the subluxation of the lateral condyle and this double shadow on the medial side. And here, if you can see this, if you looked at the CT scans, you can see that that depression was slightly more anteriorly. So it's a bit difficult to get it from the back. And we need to deal with the lateral side as well. So here what we did was we first looked into the lateral side. We did a submeniscal arthrotomy. Again, took off this lateral cortex to look into the depressed area. So you can see a significant depression of the lateral condyle here in more posteriorly than anteriorly. We got this loosened up and then we went on to the medial side. We actually did a medial epicondylar osteotomy. So you can see the depressed area here clearly. You do your osteotomy through this. So this is anterior, this is posterior. This is the medial collateral ligament, the epicondylar osteotomy from here. You go down, divide this, then you pull this up, put in a leg screw from front to back and a buttress plate at the back here. And then we went back to the lateral side. We elevated up the depressed segment because you have to loosen it up, elevate it up, put in bone graft into this gap here. And then we still had to deal with the lateral segment because this was way out. And in these old cases, you can't reduce it. You need to reduce the size of it. So you have to do an osteotomy to reduce the lateral segment. So we excise a bit of bone from this lateral segment with a saw. Nibble it out so that this fragment will close in nicely and be congruent with the lateral condyle of the femur. So that's when we complete our fixation. We fix the medial epicondylar osteotomy here. And this is now you can see how the joint is nicely congruently reduced. That's the spike washer and screw for the medial epicondyle. And this is him at 4.5 months post-op. And this is him at 9 months. This is him, he had 15 months post-op. You can see he's walking quite well at this stage. As I said, that sometimes you have to deal with bony and ligamentous problems at the same time. This is a 27-year-old gentleman who presented elsewhere, and this was the initial X-ray done. The femur was nailed, and it's only after that they realized that there was a fracture in the tibial condyle. And you can see here how you have a medial condylar fracture, but you also have a lateral collateral avulsion of the femur in this particular case. And that was how it was fixed at that time because I don't think they realized the lateral ligamentous injury. And he came to us about 4.5 months after this with gross instability. You can see how he tends to go into varus when he's trying to bend his knee. The femur luckily had healed, but this condyle had gone into varus plus he had the lateral collateral ligamentous instability. So here, even though this was actually an intra-articular fracture, it kind of went all the way, almost across to the lateral side. So we decided to just do a opening wedge osteotomy through this area, okay, so, and do a lateral collateral ligament reattachment with the fragment of bone onto the lateral side in a slightly lower position than originally, okay. So that was the correction we got. And this is him 1 year post-op. He had a bit of infection in the region of the plate. So we removed the plate, but this is him at 1.5 years post-op doing quite well. And his knee is quite stable. He's able to squat and he is well aligned. So I think with these few cases, I'm going to talk about one poor outcome where we had this 55-year-old man who had delayed surgery elsewhere. So he had this, he went into malunion, someone operated it, and this is what he ended up, and he came to us totally stiff. So he had this fixed flexion deformity with only a jog of movement. And he had this same problem, similar to the last one. The medial condyle wasn't adequately reduced. And he had this gap with subluxation of the lateral side. So we did all this because this was almost 1.5 years. We corrected it very similar. We got this joint reduced reasonably well, as well as the medial, posteromedial segment. We put a distractor on for some time because this was very late. This was him when we took out the distractor, looking reasonably good. But he, because he was stiff pre-op, he had almost just about 30 degrees motion. So we did arthroscopic arthrolysis and got him bending to about 90 degrees. But he again developed some stiffness. And then in the physiotherapy, with overzealous physiotherapy, ended up breaking his distal femur here. So by then, he did not want any further surgery. So we treated that in a cast for some time, for 6 weeks in a cast. And he ended up finally with about this much movement, so maybe about 30 to 40 degrees movement. Was quite happy with the result, but not a perfect result. We actually did a CT scan to just look at, and we found that we've got quite a good intra-articular correction of his deformity, but obviously not a very satisfactory result. So I think with that, I'll conclude. I think intra-articular malunions need careful assessment. You need to assess the clinical problem and also the possibility of reconstruction. So there are some situations where obviously in an older patient, maybe doing a primary arthroplasty may be a better option. I think you need to plan your osteotomies carefully to address both the intra and extra-articular elements of the deformity. And as you can see, the results can be quite gratifying. So these patients, if you did nothing for them, would definitely progress to significant arthritis very soon and then end up with having to have some more major procedure which or a joint replacement very early in life. So thank you very much. I will stop there. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. John. I think any question from the faculty you can take, or else if there is any question in the channel, Shudeep or Tamsul.
No question has come up yet to me. Samshul, if there are any questions on your end, please go ahead. Or no faculty question can.
No question for
Hello.
Gurudev, yes, please go ahead.
Gurudev is there. Gurudev,
Good evening, sir. Question for John, sir. Sir, bicondylar deformity, neglected case malunion and depressed fragment. What are the sequence of approaching the that fragment, sir?
So I think you need to assess it very carefully, and you can approach it in any way, but you need depends on you. Don't do your fixation till you've got both sides corrected. Okay. You understand? So if it's a posteromedial fragment depression, I would approach that first, get that reduced. The lateral side, it depends on the situation. I think it's very difficult to give a cookbook answer for every case. I think you have to assess them case-wise and then decide which sequence you're going to approach. I mean, we've had even more complex cases where a fragment of the anteromedial part is outside the joint. So where you have to actually completely separate this fragment from the rest of the joint before you can get it back in. Okay, so I think it varies very much from each case. You need to look where the main deformity is. There are cases where they may have deformities on both sides, but one side is very significant, the other side is not that significant. So we might just do one of the two. Okay, so recently we had a case where we had a significant posteromedial depression on one side and a very slight step on the lateral side. And he also had post-op infection earlier, which we had to treat. So we decided that it's safer for us to just do one side than try to do both sides at the same time. And because we got a good correction on one side and the other side was fairly minimal, we decided to just leave it at that. So I think you have to judge each case separately and then decide. Mangal, what's your experience with them?
Mangal, sir?
He's still there.
Sir, for intra-articular osteotomy, I think malunited proximal tibia fracture, the most important part is decision making. So what are the investigation you suggest? It's only based on X-ray, or sometimes you prefer to do a routine CT scan or 3D CT scan and MRI before planning?
So as I mentioned, CT scan in these are almost mandatory. So we would do everything that was done earlier in terms of X-rays of both knees, long leg films, and then also do a CT with 3D reconstruction for the intra-articular details. We don't do an MRI routinely, but if you have significant ligamentous laxity, we would also do an MRI. So that's fairly standard for.
So for a large gap, what a bone graft do you use?
So for these, we usually use autologous bone graft from the iliac crest. Okay, because here you have a problem of healing problems as well. So I'm not just happy with autograft. But if it is just a small, like in one case, used a Kronos, where it was just a depression, it was not a healing problem. Okay, some of them also have non-unions, etc. And so I would use bone substitute or bone graft. We don't have access to allograft to use allograft. So.
And sir, any experience of aseptic serous discharge, Kronos and all artificial bone substitutes?
So I think that's very common with stimulan, okay? Okay, so that's something you have to be careful with. Especially where you use it. Kronos, we've not had that problem. Okay, now with G-bone apparently, but I've never used G-bone. I think it's something which I would avoid using personally. But I know economically some people would have to use it. With stimulan, especially where we use it for infected situations with antibiotics, some of these will continue to seep for a long time. It's sometimes confusing to decide between whether you need to worry about it because of infection or it's something that happens. I think Mangal's got a fair amount of experience with stimulan, so maybe he can comment on that.
Yeah, if it is superficial, sometimes yes, you get that, but it tends to
especially
be
for the soft tissue
sterile
ones,
discharge, so I don't worry about that too much.
And it's an experience of post-op hematoma with a HTO without bone graft.
Okay, so HTO without bone graft, so we don't put bone graft in any of our HTOs. Okay, so what we do as a routine is to, once we've done our osteotomy, we use a crepe bandage, release the tunicae, leave the crepe bandage on for at least 7 to 8 minutes, then take off the crepe bandage, look for any major bleeders, and then close up the osteotomy, okay? So I wouldn't say we've not had any problems, but we've probably had to explore about 4 wounds out of the 100 odd that we've had to do for a hematoma.
But osteotomized bone will always ooze. How can we control?
No. This is a Staubli trick. I had the privilege of assisting him for a couple of
something which was actually recommended by Staubli in one of the meetings that we had.
Which is they don't, it's not written anywhere in the technique. But what they do is, once you've completed the osteotomy, put the plate, you finish your wash and all that, and then you release the tunicae, and as John said, you keep it on for 7. I leave it on for 10 minutes. I'm a very impatient person, so I tend to wash out and then wash in again to prevent myself from being too quick. But when you open it, what you find is that gap has been filled by a clot,
basically.
So there's hardly any bleeding. And what he says is, this is the clot which is vital. So you finish all your washing, everything before, then don't disturb the clot and catch whatever bleeders, etc. So you have to ensure good hemostasis. And then you close it. If you do that, then there is I've in the limited numbers that I have done, I've never had to open it.
So
if you follow that.
Two or three in the more than 100 odd that we've done. So
can we move on to the last?
Yeah.
So you're muted.
Bhushan sir, does you get more of a bleeding because you do more release posteriorly?
I think it's possible to get a bit of bleeding, but if you are careful enough in your hemostasis when you're going in, and if the osteotomy space is closed properly, with a blood clot, as was discussed or mentioned by both Mangal and John, I don't think it bleeds too much. I tend to put a drain. Most of people don't, but I like to put a drain for 48 hours after the surgery and to avoid a hematoma formation. But it doesn't bleed torrentially as such.
No, we use a drain as well. So we use a drain, but we don't open the drain for 4 hours. Okay, so we put on the suction drain, but don't start the suction till 3 or 4 hours after that, after the release of the tourniquet.
Okay, Arvind, I think John, we can move forward for the last one.
Yeah, sure. Sorry, I've stopped sharing. So
yeah. I think Arvind, now you are welcome. Arvind, you are ready with your presentation. Yeah.
So after a lot of STO discussion, now STO with ACL reconstruction is there. We all know ACL rupture leads to increased internal rotation of the tibia. So this leads to shifting of the center of rotation of the knee joint toward the medial compartment. And these two in vitro studies says with the ACL deficit knee, the contact pressure over the posterior aspect of the condyle of the tibia is very high. So these two phenomena, one is shifting toward the anteromedial side, another toward the posterior compartment, these leads to development of cupula. That is the loss of articular cartilage from the posteromedial aspect of the tibia. And this loss of cartilage leads to development of the varus deformity, which is well written in this articles also. So those who are having ACL deficit will have greater varus and internal rotation of the tibia. And we all know the osteoarthritis will develop in such type of cases, those who are having varus deformity, and any varus deformity of more than 3 degrees should be corrected. And varus deformity of 4 degrees will increase the risk of development of osteoarthritis by 3 times. And the rate of progression is almost 10 to 20 times faster. All these change in kinematics and the pathology of the knee joint with ACL deficit knee is still there in those knee don't having any instability symptom. So these things also should be kept in mind. And also when this ACL deficiency is associated with meniscal lesion, these change in kinematics get exaggerated. So there is a lot of discussion over the coronal plane deformity in form of varus knee, and some discussion also about the posterior tibial slope, which vary on the medial side, it is in between 9 to 11 degree, and on lateral side, it is 6 to 8 degree. And anything which is more than 12 degree is taken as abnormal. So this is for the bony posterior tibial slope. There is concept of soft tissue posterior tibial slope is also there, which is formed by the meniscus and the cartilage, which is well studied and published in this recent literature also, that there is significant reduction in the posterior tibial slope by the posterior horn of the medial and lateral meniscus. And DeJoer, in very early days, he says there is directly proportionate between the increase in the posterior tibial slope and the anterior translation of the tibia. And Graffin in 2004 says, if there is increasing tibial slope, this may be beneficial in PCL deficit knee. This decreases the posterior tibial sag. And similarly, if the slope is less, this will be beneficial in anterior ACL deficit knee because it decreases the anterior tibial translation. And the landmark paper in the same year by Lowenhofer, it was a biomechanical study, which progressively increases the slope and look for the posterior subluxation of the tibia, which was reduced as the slope increases. So it was beneficial in the PCL deficit knee. Similarly, those who are having ACL deficit, there will be anterior translation of the tibia, which get exaggerated with slope get increased. And if we correct the slope toward the normal side or maybe toward the 0 degree of posterior tibial slope, this translation get decreased. So we have seen the development of this cupula formation because of anterior translation of the tibia. And medial meniscus is very important back to the anterior translation of the tibia. And a study says if anterior translation of tibia is more than 6 millimeter, there is 70% chances of injury to the posterior horn of the medial meniscus or posterior medial corner. And if this translation is more than 1 centimeter, then the chances of injury to this posterior medial side is almost more than 90%. So this injury to the posterior horn of the medial meniscus or posterior medial component will further exaggerate the anterior tibial translation. And this further leads to injury to the posterior medial side of the cartilage. And this make a cycle that leads to secondary osteoarthritis development on the medial compartment of the knee joint. And the Fowler in very early time, 1994, says, if you do HTO, so all these progression can be stopped. So he did HTO alone in ACL deficit knee with varus thrust and medial compartment osteoarthritis having significant clinical improvement. Nays in American Journal of Sports Medicine 2000 again having very good result. It was started with close wedge high tibial osteotomy with the advantage that the posterior slope get automatically decreased with the closed with the osteotomy. But the associated complication is very high with this, like injury to the proximal tibia fibula joint, anterior compartment. The injury to the peroneal nerve is almost up to 27%. So now people have shifted toward the open wedge high tibial osteotomy. While doing this osteotomy for the ACL, focus should be here, like the posterior opening should be high than the anterior opening. At the same time, the placement of plate should be posterior. It should not be anterior. Because a study by the Craig M. in a Sports Journal of Sports Medicine says anterior plate application in HTO will increase the posterior slope by almost 6 degrees as compared to the posterior plate placement. So when you are doing the high tibial osteotomy for ACL deficiency, try to place the plate posterior. Like this patient, this was our first patient with ACL deficiency in which we did HTO. Diagnosed the ACL tear in 2003, but managed conservatively by herself, and 2016 presented with severe varus deformity with severe OA on the medial compartment. And there was frank instability also. The MRI says all the signs of this chronic ACL deficiency with medial compartment OA. And this patient was managed with high tibial osteotomy alone. Before this, we were doing high tibial osteotomy alone for PCL insufficiency cases with very good result. But in this case, ACL deficiency with HTO alone, this case didn't work very well. So again, we look backward and see the de jure in very early days added ACL reconstruction to all his HTO patients with 91% satisfaction rate. Rusi in 2011, added ACL reconstruction to all his ACL deficient knee along with HTO. So later on, this patient with medial compartment osteoarthritis with 10 year of ACL deficit knee, along with there is varus deformity also. And again, MRI says all the signs of this ACL deficiency with medial compartment osteoarthritis. And orthoscopically, we can see the cupula along with injury to the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. The lateral compartment was absolutely fine. So ACL reconstruction was done. And later on, in the same sitting, high tibial osteotomy was planned. And this was the, and also the prevent the posterior opening collapse, the graft was also used in this case, because only 2S proximal screw was used. So ACL reconstruction with STO was done in this case. This patient did very well. Another patient with 38 year male of 6 year old ACL injury presented with the medial compartment osteoarthritis. And MRI says there is injury to the posterior meniscal root also. You can see here. And there is varus deformity also. So we all know the root tear is act as a total meniscectomy. This decreases the contact area and increases the pressure. So very high pressure over the joint in case of root tear. So along with the HTO, ACL reconstruction, and the root repair was also done in this cases. And again, attention was placed over the excess more posterior opening in case of in comparison to anterior opening. So it should be the trapezoidal one. Many a time, definitely it is not possible to decrease the tibial slope because lateral hinge is still there. So it's almost sometime impossible to decrease the tibial slope. So later on, this all these literature says, there is comparison between HTO and HTO with ACL reconstruction. Good to excellent results seems more with the HTO plus ACL group. Another study, again, ACL plus HTO with more than 90% satisfaction rate. In Orthoscopy Journal, recently 2015, systemic review says the simultaneous HTO and ACL reconstruction was a salvage procedure for physiologically active young patient because it's restore the anterior stability, alleviate the, all the symptom from the medial compartment, and improvement of the subjective evaluation. Another recent systemic review says, despite of lack of the high quality study, it seems that one stage high tibial osteotomy and anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction is a safe procedure for treatment of patient suffering from symptomatic varus osteoarthritis along with the anterior knee instability. Thank you.
Thank you, Arvind.
Yeah.
Any queries, Hamsul?
No questions, sir. No questions.
Question is coming in the net.
One question, Arvind. How do you fix your tibial side of the graft when you do in the same setting HTO with ACL reconstruction?
So most of the time your screw is in between the proximal row and the osteotomy part. Only thing that if you are using Tomofix, then you have to escape the most anterior screw while you are doing it. But the recently the plate that Bhushan sir has shown, that is having different space in between the most anterior one and the middle one. And in between that, you can place your tibial tunnel screw.
Arvind, just one question. Sequence of your surgery, sequence of your osteotomy, and sequence of your tunnel making, and sequence of fixation. Can you just take us through the sequence?
Though many literature say first do HTO, then you do ACL part, but I'm doing first ACL part from very beginning. And my screw tunnel is, I know, in between the proximal row of screw and the osteotomy part. Because osteotomy is almost at the level of hamstring we start. So I know I have my space is there. And try to I make it more toward the tibial, to more central. It's not toward the medial side. And then I don't fix the tibial part. First, I fix the pass the graft and fix the graft on the femoral side. Usually, it's suspensory fixation. Then I do HTO part. And usually, I miss the anterior most screw. Then pass the two screw posterior. And just the second row screw and all the distal screw after completion of this STO part, then I fix that tibial graft.
In the end, you pass the graft and fix the graft.
No, the graft is passed. You just fix it.
Graft is passed and kept there and fixation is done in the end.
Yes.
So what do you prefer, an all-inside method in this case, an STO, all-inside?
Sudeep.
Can I just make one observation?
Yes, sir.
We need to differentiate between ACL reconstruction, where you reduce slope and correct the varus. Though technically it is a high tibial osteotomy, this is being done to prevent re-injury re-breaking or re-damage of the ACL. Whereas in a patient who's 40, 45 years old, who's come with established medial compartment osteoarthritis, and incidentally you discover a ACL tear, without usually these patients almost never will have symptoms of instability. Those patients, even if they have a medial root tear, etc., they only need a high tibial osteotomy. So the clinical presentation is also important. Is the patient presenting with MCOA? Because now, most of us are aware that there are studies and a large number of studies which show that ACL reconstruction does not reduce the incidence of future osteoarthritis.
So I think I think what Mangal is asking, whether there is at all any need of ACL reconstruction anywhere with the combining with the HTO.
No, it is. When the patient comes with symptoms of instability, the 25-year-old footballer, and you find that he's got varus. So there you will correct, you will do the ACL.
You have to combine.
You will also try and correct the slope. There, yes. But I am asking in the 45-year-old
incidental
come with medial compartment, like the patient that you showed, came in 2016, injured the ACL in 2003. According to me,
by around 40, 45. By around 40-45, they are less symptomatic about the instability. Rather, they are more problematic with the varus and the osteoarthritis. So
that has been my observation.
I think some of them still have instability. Okay, so because they have neglected their injuries, not that they have not had any symptoms. Okay, they have neglected the injury because they've not had pain, and now they're having pain, so they come for treatment. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think if they have clinical instability, I think you need to deal with it, because if you don't, then
that's what I said. If you just discover ACL incidentally on the MRI,
I think those cases can come out with HTO only.
Another one thing, probably with permission of John, I am telling what Sudeep was asking, what should be the sequence of doing the tunnels and the HTO.
Sure.
Basically, thing is that before doing the HTO and everything, you do the femoral tunnel completely done with the femoral ones. Okay. Then you do your osteotomy, then you do your tomofix, then you take out your first screw. And then you do your tunnel and take one dilator, metallic dilator that you keep in the tibial tunnel. Then we can redirect your screw in whatever way you can go ahead. So if you do, if you are all done with the femoral tunnel, then you apply your tomofix, then keep those last two screws, take the front screw. And then you in the one dilator you keep in the tibial tunnel. So once you pass the graft, you know that this screw is not going to hit the tibial tunnel. If it is hitting, you don't put that screw. If it is not hitting, then you can still put the screw. So this is the sequence of doing the ACL with the HTO.
I think Samsul is giving red signal now because he has to start another webinar at 6:30. Sudeep,
we can have
vote of thanks. And
I guess everyone has his own way of dealing with this. So I think some people like to do the osteotomy. I think it makes sense to do your arthroscopic part and get over that and then do your osteotomy. And of course, your final fixation of your graft you need to do after you've done your...
Yes, sir. So, normally, we follow that sequence only.
Yeah.
Yes, Sudeep. Yes.
Yeah, I think Dr. Madhusudan, I would request him to thank all the panelists and all the speakers here. It has been really wonderful session. All sorts of questions were asked for beginners and for those who are already doing it, a lot of doubts were cleared. So we'll thank all the speakers from Clement sir, Mangal sir, John sir, Rajiv, Sonindu sir, Arvind, all of you. Thank you very much. Gurudev is also there, Dr. Rakesh Chaudhary. So I think all of them have shifted to another platform for the next talk. I think our president and our secretary has shifted. So I think we can end our session here. Yes. This was a wonderful session.
Great. Thanks.
Yeah. And thank you all for joining us on Sunday evening.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Thank you.